Hey, PCWorld fans, Adam and Gordon here. We're here with a very special guest, Brad Shoemaker from Nextlander and TechPod fame. This is to sit down and have a discussion about building a PC. Brad, you're in need of a PC. We here like to build PCs, so I think it's a match made in heaven.
Yes, I've come to the right place.
Nice. So in this video, we're going to kind of go over what your current rig is, what you do, what you need to do with this new PC, and it's not to settle on a specific parts list just yet. It's more to inform the parts list that will come, and then in some time from now, we're going to do a live build with these parts. So to start off, why don't you inform our viewers, Brad, who you are and what you do?
Hello, I'm Brad Shoemaker. I've been in the games press for 20 couple odd years at this point. Worked at GameSpot, was at Giant Bomb for quite a while. Now independent with a couple of my Giant Bomb alumni at Nextlander, and also co-host of Brad and Will Made a Tech Pod with your friend Will Smith and mine. So that's me professionally.
So obviously you use your PC a lot right now, but what PC are you using right now? Please go over the specs of this PC.
I'm on still a 7700K. Which began life as a 6700K. That chip got moved to another machine. Got a good lightning deal, stuck a 77 in there.
Wow, okay.
Still going strong. Just passed 7 years on this machine.
7700K.
Gordon staring.
No, it's if it works.
I'd never intended to go this long. I had plans to build a new one a couple years ago. You know, pandemic and business stuff happened. It just kind of didn't come together.
Wow. Okay.
Do you want specs?
I can. No, please. Yeah, run over all the specs.
So it's a 7700K. It's 16 gig of I believe it's PC 3200, DDR4.
Okay.
I do have a 3080 in there. A launch 10 gig 3080. I did make that upgrade.
What did you start with?
Gosh, I don't remember.
Oh, okay. Oh, right, but the 3080 is.
What was the hot graphics card of 2015? I'm trying to remember.
980.
So the 970? No, I put a 970 in that machine as an upgrade, I want to say.
Oh, wow, okay.
Anyway, yeah, 3080. I do have an NVMe system drive, boot drive.
Oh, okay.
So I think it's a 970 Evo, if I'm not mistaken. That's probably all the relevant stuff. I mean, there's other, you know, networking and capture stuff in there, but that's the, those are the.
So you do have other PCIe cards?
Yes, I actually have, and I look at motherboards all the time and like rue the lack of PCIe slots. I have four PCIe cards in my machine right now.
Oh, okay. Boy.
I see the winces on your face.
Yeah, that's just hard to do with modern.
One of them is disposable. Another one could be disposable.
Huh.
So
graphics card's obviously by 16.
Yes.
Card number two is by.
So I've got an Elgato capture card in there.
So four lanes.
That's
in, probably.
Four, I believe.
Yeah, yeah.
I've got a Mellanox network adapter in there, 40 gigabit network that I run to my NAS.
Four lanes, or you could almost do that.
I think
that
it's four.
Okay.
That's basically a data center pull, so I'm super familiar with the specs on it.
Okay.
The other one is just a USB expansion card. It's like it's a 1X.
That's good.
It's not a huge deal.
So you basically lease 1x16 and probably 2x4s.
That should be fine. Okay. Yeah. And like there are good USB capture options. If it really comes down to it and I have to lose the capture card, it's not the end of the world.
Going kind of what you do today and what you need out of a PC today, where are the problems you're hitting with this? Or another way to phrase it is like
everywhere.
I suspect it's a case of like I don't know what I don't know, or I don't know what I'm missing.
Oh, really?
Because I'm used to it.
So it's working for you.
My instinct is to say like it's fine, it's still going, you know. But like also, everybody I know that works in hardware is like.
Yeah.
Promise when you sit down in front of a new machine, you're going to see it. You're going to feel it instantly.
Okay, so you don't have any necessarily problems. It's just it's slow.
Like newer games, like I know I'm giving up a ton of frame rate because of that CPU.
Okay.
I would say even so. Actually, my other use case. I don't know if we want to just get into like
use cases here,
but like heavy multitasking is I think becoming an issue. Like it's still doable, but it's getting a little fraught. So like frequently, I will be playing a game which I'm streaming out, so it needs to run at, you know, full frame rate. Also running OBS to stream it somewhere. Also potentially running Parsec or vMix call or some other like relatively heavy video application.
Mm-hmm.
and any number of other things in the background, mm-hmm. and like I think that starts to get a little heavy.
Like, yeah, I'm almost kind of surprised that you haven't run into problems. You know,
there have been cases where I like push the OBS scene, the complexity of the scene a little too much.
Yeah, wow.
Like, this machine cannot handle compositing all this stuff together right now.
And, so. and when you do the stream, are you doing anything with the footage afterward? Are you doing like rendering?
Not typically. So I mean, to get in the weeds a little bit, I'm typically actually sending my feed to somebody else who is ingesting it and adding it to a larger scene, streaming that final scene out to the internet. So typically I don't need to keep that footage. There will be cases here and there though where I will need to save it locally.
Okay, and so would... I'm just trying to think of like a priority list of what you're doing. Like, is gaming number one and then multitasking, or is it like, multitasking is the be all end all and gaming is a part of it?
Yeah, I've thought about this a lot leading up to this, and I swear I'm not just like quoting from the 7950X 3D marketing copy, but like for weeks I've been thinking like I'm going to go in there and be like, I need both. Like, I need some of everything, because games are definitely super important. But I'm doing enough productivity, production, you know, kind of heavy number crunching, heavy compute stuff as well, that I think that is probably just as important for me at this point. Like, I'm working with a lot of audio and video. I'm doing a fair amount of encoding and compressing stuff. Like, to put it in context, like, the 7-zip benchmarks I saw going around were, like, kind of interest to me. I was kind of excited to see stuff like that.
Okay.
Like, very much less frequently, but still occasionally, like compiling software as well. So like a lot of like heavily threaded stuff.
Okay,
as well as the games.
So for gaming, whether it's during a stream or even just in your off hours, what resolution frame rates are you pushing?
1440p, 144 hertz.
Oh, okay.
Is where I'm at. I don't feel the pull to go to 4K on the desktop anytime soon. So
oh, okay.
It's one monitor.
I have two.
Okay. Two monitors. Yeah, two. And they're both 1440p.
Both the same model. Okay. They're both ASUS 27-inch 1440p.
FreeSync, G-Sync.
FreeSync.
FreeSync. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I think I'd kind of rather have the extra frames rather than the extra resolution at the desktop.
Is there anything in your workflow that uses, let's say, QuickSync? Or AVX 512, which is kind of like, I'm just trying to think of where.
So I'd like to tinker. I like to fiddle with stuff constantly. So like potentially anything and everything. Like, I'm not QuickSync. I use NVENC quite a bit. In fact, I use NVENC all the time for sending video out, like I mentioned. Trying to think, like, AVX 512 has a lot of use cases in like different emulators, like PlayStation 3 emulation uses it a lot, stuff like that. So like, I like to mess with stuff like that. The other thing that I've just started to dabble with is like machine learning type stuff.
Like
large language model, AI, whatever terms you want to throw around.
Huh.
Like, I've started using Whisper, the OpenAI speech to text.
Oh, okay. Yes.
Recently, like, that comes in handy for podcast transcription purposes.
Yeah, interesting.
And of everything I've been doing on this machine lately, that's the one where I was like, oh
wow,
okay.
No, I can see that.
Will does some stuff too there, and he had warned me. He was like, hey, that's going to hit your memory. That's going to hit your GPU like really hard. And
interesting.
Sure enough, like everything bogged down while I was trying to run a podcast through that thing. The first time I was just like, oh, okay, it's time for a new machine.
So we've talked about kind of use cases, but in terms of hardware, if we can kind of get into a little bit, obviously the heart of the system, we're kind of looking at Intel versus AMD. I know you're on an Intel system, but you've kind of had your sights on AMD. Where are you sitting at it right now, especially now that we've seen the 7950X 3D reviews?
That thing is like so close to exactly what I want. Like, the only concern I have, and I don't know if it's that big of a concern, you know, like Gordon touched on this, like the, you know, parking the other die while you're playing a game.
Mm.
Like I said, I'm going to be having a lot of situations where, I guess I should describe the situation I'm worried about, which is like playing a game, need to do those three or four other things that I mentioned. Maybe it doesn't wake up the other die fast enough, or like it just doesn't, you know, whatever its like threshold is for like, hey, it's time to push those tasks over. Maybe it doesn't hit that threshold to the point that it hits game performance. That could just be paranoia. Like, that's the only like real reservation I have about that thing. But otherwise, like, the specs, and especially also the power consumption now that I work at home full time. So like,
you'd rather have efficiency and less heat,
like a sweet spot of like good productivity, good gaming, good performance per watt, like the whole thing across the board. Like, it's kind of a jack of all trades to me. Is kind of my feeling, but
And then obviously, I mean, we're talking about a much newer chipset. do you have USB 3 on?
Yes.
The Z1? Yeah. Okay, yeah. But a USB-C probably is not.
It has one USB-C.
Oh, it does. Oh, okay. It does, yeah. Yeah. Do you care about Thunderbolt?
It actually has one 3.1. What is the red USB-C A port? Or I said USB A port that's red. Is that USB 3.1?
It doesn't mean anything.
Probably not.
Yeah.
The color doesn't mean anything. Yeah. It's probably either 5 or 10 gig, right? So
that sounds right. Sorry.
Do you care about Thunderbolt? Is that a necessity for you at all?
No.
Okay. Just trying to think of a platform, you know, where do you think the other strengths and weaknesses are versus AMD versus Intel?
Well, I mean, a
holistic platform approach.
It just sounds like, you mess a little bit with AVX 512. You definitely need more cores. Gaming is important. So again, that's the cache kind of plays nice there. I was asking about QuickSync and AVX 512 because AMD has AVX 512. Intel doesn't right now. Yeah. And of course, Intel has QuickSync, and they're both sort of like definitely paths you have to take if you're going to follow. So it sounds like you don't use anything that uses QuickSync. So
I find NVENC kind of fills that same role pretty well.
Okay. So and you don't use any sort of creative applications like the Adobe Suite or DaVinci or anything like that?
My workflow is extremely sort of free and open source. Like, I use Audacity, I use OBS, I use a lot of like command line tools like FFmpeg and stuff like that. So not really in the professional creative space too much.
Oh, okay.
That's just kind of where I lean. I mean.
Okay, but it does sound like when we're talking about GPUs, NVIDIA is probably where you're feeling more comfortable with. Because the NVENC, you're so reliant on.
This whole thing feels so narcissistic. It's like, I need to do this and this and this.
That's what this is.
No, I know what it's about. But it's just like, so like on the gaming side, I think like, from a sort of professional curiosity standpoint, keeping up with ray tracing is pretty valuable for me.
Okay.
Like, there's been a lot of stuff that I just kind of didn't bother to look at on this current system, even though like the 3080 is decent on ray tracing, but that CPU is definitely holding it back. So like, I've never tried Cyberpunk with ray tracing on, for example. So I think like, I feel like we're kind of just getting to the point where it's like actually really playable frame rates on that stuff now, especially with the ray trace GI stuff in some games now. So like, being able to keep track of that stuff and kind of see what the state of the art is there would be handy.
And that card doesn't have AV1 support, which the new generations of GPUs. Yeah. So how interested are you in AV1?
Like, very from a kind of philosophical standpoint. Like,
but you're probably not there to use it yet.
No. So I like I said, I won't be streaming to Twitch from this machine too much, but I would definitely, like, we would integrate it into our workflow now. Like, we use H.265 to stream to each other.
Oh, okay.
Because that's more efficient for the same, you're getting better quality for the same bitrate. So we're already kind of past 264 on stuff like that. So, you know, once the tool chain catches up, because like vMix doesn't support AV1 yet, like, it's going to take a while for stuff to catch up there, but we absolutely would and probably will use it once everything lines up.
So it'd be nice to have.
Yeah, for sure. Of course, it sounds like, I mean, practically every card out there now has got support for that. So.
Well, I'm trying to gauge, you know, I mean, obviously pairing your 3080 with a newer CPU, you actually probably would get a benefit.
Sure.
But, you know, like what kind of benefit would you get from going to a newer GPU as well?
Yeah.
Is the CPU upgrade enough?
I see,
GPU upgrades, you know what, you get AV1, you get the newest NVENC, you get...
Yeah,
you know,
in that context, the AV1 support would absolutely be useful down the line once stuff supports it more.
Okay, and just thinking about the rest of the platform, you know, what's in the PC. So we talked about PCIe slots. It sounds like you need full ATX. You couldn't go mini ITX. A small form factor builds out of the
I've kind of gone the other way these days. Like, I kind of just want the biggest of everything.
Oh, okay.
Just
okay.
Extensible, expandable.
Yeah.
Just get the biggest case, like get an EATX or whatever, you know. Just you guys have talked about, you know, like that feeling of like, oh God, I gotta take out a drive or cut this case open to fit this graphics card in. Like that, I hate that feeling.
I mean,
feeling.
Even full ATX is having that problem lately.
Yeah, so like, just trying to keep everything as big and open as possible, I think, is kind of the way I'm leaning for what at the end of the day needs to be like a good gaming machine, a good workstation, a good kind of everything.
Okay. And what about storage? What kind of storage do you have now? What kind of storage do you wish you had?
Let's see. So I've got a NAS. That's what that network card goes out to, that has like 50 terabytes of redundant storage in it. So like, but that's like, that's over a network. That's cold storage. Like, that's not.
Oh, it's cold storage. You don't use that for file transfer.
Well, I definitely like move stuff back and forth. What I mean is like, you can't host like a Steam library on that, for example. But as far as like bulk storage, like I certainly don't need hard drives in this machine. Like, I don't need spinning, or even like
big. Even for like backup. Or where do you back up your computer to? NAS or.
Maybe not as good about local backup of that machine as I could be. But also, I don't really... Anything, like, crucial goes on the NAS where I've got redundancy and backups built in.
Okay.
It's my PC is just kind of game installs and, like, stuff I'm working on and anything that just gets dragged onto the desktop before I archive it, I guess I would say. So, like... I guess I would say, like, less fast storage is more important than, like, a bunch of slower storage in the workstation.
Okay.
I guess I would say.
That makes sense.
Like, but also, like, you know, some Steam like game installs are getting pretty big these days. So.
Yeah. God, right. Well, I mean, what did, if you were like, oh man, you know, how many games do you have installed at one moment? How many games do you wish you had installed at one moment?
Have or like should have are different questions. Have, of course, a bunch of them are indies that are like 500 megabytes.
Like, I mean, but are you somebody like, man, you know what? It's nice to just have it ready to go anytime. The bigger the better.
I'm 1,000% the person who like wants. I have like 180 games installed right now.
Okay.
Just in case. Well, a lot of those are like stuff I downloaded for work, and it's like, oh, maybe we'll get back to that at some point.
And
you know, I certainly could get by with a lot less, but like, I tend to like to have a lot of stuff installed if possible.
Okay. And do you segment it? Like, do you have your games on your OS drive?
No. So my NVMe drive is only half a gig. So.
Okay.
Pretty restrictive for game installs.
Yeah. Half a terabyte, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. You said half a gig.
Sorry.
I was like, that's a pretty small install.
Half a terabyte. Yeah. Yes. my games drive is, I think, four SSDs lashed together with Windows storage spaces.
Wow, okay.
If you're familiar with that.
For a total of what?
It's a gig. There I go again. It's a terabyte and a half.
Oh, okay, total.
It's like,
four.
You know, you build up SSDs over time, and it's like, these are SATA 3.
They're all SATA.
SATA, but they're all big enough, you know. It's like, ashamed to chuck these in a drawer.
They're still valuable.
And I've still got SATA ports, so I was like, you can turn them all into one logical drive with storage spaces. So that is my game install drive for now.
Okay, what about like the projects you're working on? You know, whether it's
media stuff. I have an SSD in my NAS that I use for as a kind of a working drive that's a lot faster than the hard drives in there.
So that
kind of works for stuff like that.
Would you benefit from having it local?
Yes, for sure.
Oh, okay.
It would definitely be nice to have more
local storage.
I'd say at least like 2 to 4 terabytes locally would certainly be a lot less restrictive than what I'm working with. Like, I'm constantly eyeballing the free space on my system drive.
Right.
Because 512 gig is not a ton for a system drive these days.
What kind of RAM requirements do you need? Are you okay with 32? Do you need 64? Do you need the fastest speed?
Right up until like 3 weeks ago, I thought 32 was gonna be totally fine, and it very well still may be. The only thing is when I started messing with Whisper and started doing some of that AI stuff, like I was looking in Task Manager and it was completely saturating every bit of my 16 gig. And Will had warned me about that because he messes with Stable Diffusion and Dolly and stuff on his machine, and he was like, hey, this is the most RAM hungry thing you can do. So that kind of spooked me a little bit. Like, 64 still feels like overkill, but like I want. The other thing is, part of this is platform dependent, but like if I did end up on AMD, we're right at the beginning of AM5, and so there's like a good long upgrade runway on that. And my experience with 4 DIMMs and a board is maybe not ideal, but so it would be like future proofing, but I don't know if it's like strictly necessary right now. Probably not. Like,
but more capacity over clocks.
Definitely. Okay. I would definitely, like, if it came down, if somebody was like, here's 32 of 7,600 or 64 of 6,000, I would take the 64.
Okay.
For sure.
Okay.
I mean, you guys are the experts. I don't know if memory bandwidth is a big deal these days or not.
I mean, it depends on what you do. For gaming, it can be dependent.
Sure.
For sure. But I mean, not really capacity wise. Yeah. It's more the speed.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
But I mean, if you're multitasking, you know, obviously.
Yeah.
You've got more things trying to vie for that resource.
You're starting to see, like, I don't know if this is like a trend or if this is just like Forspoken is not an efficient port, but like the recommended is 32 on that one. So like we're starting to see some stuff in that space, but again,
pretty high requirements lately. Yeah.
But I don't know if that could be an outlier. I don't know if that's representative of the way things are going or not. Like I would guess 32 is probably fine. It's really just a question of how much extra headroom, potentially a very excessive amount of headroom do I need?
Hmm. Keeping with the motherboard, how many USB ports do you feel is minimum? Or are you just like, oh man, give me as many as I can earthly have?
Definitely more is better, especially if I can't fit an expansion card in there. I'd say about six is like kind of my production need as far as camera and audio interface and, you know, different input devices and stuff like that.
Okay.
Like six plus.
Six is bare minimum.
Yeah, like six plus whatever is a reasonable
extra
for external drives and stuff like that.
Okay, what about Wi-Fi on the motherboard?
Like there are places where it would come in handy, but it's definitely not a priority. Like if it happens to be on a board, I might end up using it like two or three times over the life of the machine here and there.
What about networking or Ethernet jacks on the board? 2.5 is okay. Do you wish you had 10? Do you need 2?
I don't think I have a use case for 2, and I think 2.5 is plenty. It's tough to say where that stuff's going to end up, but like probably any like super high-end networking I do would come out of that Mellanox card anyway, so
okay.
I think 2.5 is probably going to be fine on the board.
What about peripherals? Do you need a Blu-ray drive? Do you need
I've got one. It may shock you to hear I still use one from time to time.
Oh, you do?
But I have one.
Do you need it in the case, or is it external?
Yes, I would like to.
You need it in the case. Drive. Okay, wow, drive base.
I've even got Gordon grimacing.
No, I run optical drives.
Oh, you do? Okay, great.
I'm just trying to think.
No, actually, you're in his camp now. You're like, hell yeah, drive base.
Okay. It does limit, because one option, because a lot of modern cases, even the big ones, are ditching 5.25 bays.
Yes.
I almost wonder if like we go to an external USB, like you just get an enclosure, put the drive in there.
I've got one of those too, but it's so much slower than the internal one that I tend not to use it.
Those are the typical mobile laptop pop outs.
Yeah,
so I'm saying, because a lot of that's just because those drives are slow.
Yeah.
I'm saying maybe somebody has an external cabinet, you can put a full size drive in and plug that into USB when you need it. So you get the performance, but you're not, because it really does limit your case choices if you actually have to have a drive bay.
So one of the things when we were talking to Will, he had very specific case dimensions because he likes to fit it in the back of his car. So he actually had like kind of case dimensions he was working with. You don't seem to care. The bigger the better. You could deal with a huge.
The PC belongs on the floor to me. It always has.
Yeah, nice.
So
okay.
Like it just goes on the floor next to the desk, so it can be as big as humanly possible.
See, like old timers. Okay. Old timers.
Big as humanly possible.
There's like a thing. People get angry if your PC is on the floor.
The whole phenomenon of like having it like at an angle on the desk so you can look through the window thing is like, I just don't understand.
Well, hey, you know, RGB?
Yeah, no, I get it. Okay.
Well, it's a gaming box, so you need RGB, right?
Of course.
I'm just kidding. How much do you care about aesthetics?
Aesthetics
RGB.
A lot.
Like aesthetics a lot. Okay.
RGB, not at all. Kind of like my computer look like a refrigerator, sort of, but like a really nice brushed metal. Like that's one reason I like Fractal so much, is that they have like a really nice kind of, I don't know if minimal is the term, sort of an austere vibe to them. You know, like they're very like angular. Well, they have a bunch of different models now, but I like the Define series, like the Define 7 that's out. If you look at it, it's like I kind of want it to be somewhere between like a refrigerator and like a kind of a like an onyx obelisk sort of monolith kind of thing.
Okay, wow, I like it.
They fill that niche pretty well.
And you said you care about like efficiency and heat output. What about, are you sensitive to audio? Like
how loud it is? That's the number one reason I don't bother with it. Well, stability is the number one reason I don't try to overclock, but noise is right there after that. Like I love a machine that A, isn't spinning fans up all the time, and B, when it does, like they're reasonably quiet.
How comfortable are you with like setting your own like fan profiles and things like that?
I do that stuff.
Oh, okay.
Anyway,
okay.
I'm fine with that.
Do you have a? I'm asking this. I've already seen some parts that you've talked about, but air versus liquid cooling.
Oh, I'm super fine with air these days.
But liquid cooling, you're not against either.
I honestly think I'd rather stick with air. To be honest, just to keep complexity at a minimum.
Hmm.
I know the all-in-one stuff is all quite good these days, and there's not a lot of guesswork there. But I don't know, high-end air coolers are fine with me.
All right, anything else I'm not thinking of?
I can't think of anything because you got, you know, noise, physical requirements, the drive bay is important too, right? That's a big deal. CPU, it could really, I mean, it sounds like to me.
I mean, anything's going to be an upgrade.
Anything's going to be an upgrade.
I think it really depends the Intel versus AMD. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, either way you go, you're going to be a big upgrade there. So I'm sure we'll think of other things, you know, down the road in the process of kind of figuring out the parts. But I also want to hear what the comments section has to say. What would you, knowing this information you have, What would you build for Brad? Are there any other questions you would want to ask him? Because, you know, I can always look at it and be like, oh, crap, we should ask this. maybe we can come back and look at that. So curious to see. And then, sometime in the future, we will do the live build. Be sure to look at that. Subscribe, smash the bell icon for when the notification pops up, whatever, for the live build. And it'll be fun. It'll be a good time. We love building PCs here. We love doing it live. You know, you just plan on coming in here and drinking some beer, building a PC, and having some fun for a couple hours. So thank you, Brad,
for
sitting down and chatting with us about this because, you know, as somebody who has very complex needs, I like kind of wrapping my head around like, okay, what can we do? What would make sense in this scenario? It's actually kind of nicer that you're not just, oh, I'm just going to game on it. Right. Then it's like, okay, that's kind of easy. Like this presents a little bit of a kind of a logic puzzle that we need to wrap in.
An expansive problem space.
Yeah, and then thank you for trusting in us to put it together.
Thank you. Thank you guys for the opportunity.
Yeah, so and thank you, Gordon, for your knowledge in all of this stuff. It's definitely going to be instrumental in picking the parts. So, and thank you for watching this video. Like I said, be sure to tune back in for the live stream coming up in the future. And be sure to subscribe for more PC hardware and software goodness. We'll see you later.